Hello, everyone, and welcome to Sip and Sync with Azure. Today, we're tackling a very important question: how do I build and scale my AI applications? Now, there are multiple ways to think about this. I'm going to start with a sub-question. And the sub-question would be, how do I create an AI agent or any AI-powered application or introduce new AI intelligence, any type of AI intelligence features into my existing app? These are all subparts of the same question, but kind of answered in the same way, in my opinion. So we're going to see how each of these can be answered, but really the answer is one answer, which is think about the ingredients. What are the ingredients? You'll need an infrastructure to deploy the application on. You'll need databases to have your data housed in. Then you'll need an AI platform where you do all the reasoning, but an extension of the platform would also allow you to run and operate your entire model system AI app. And then you need that application to integrate with other systems that you might already have or external systems. That's where the integration layers would come in. And then that entire application would talk to other AI agents or other apps. We'll talk a tiny bit about that as well. And then the two broad layers, which is how do you secure and monitor that entire application? And then how do you use the developer tools to increase productivity while you build this application? So that's kind of how I'm mentally thinking about all of the different components and ingredients that you need to answer that question of building AI applications on Azure. Let's start with what are your choices, right? From the database perspective, because I think that data is one of the biggest pieces or ingredients or puzzles where you need to begin for any AI application. You've got three options when you're thinking about databases. You've got software as a service, the easiest option. Then you've got platform as a service, where you have a little bit more control, right? And then you've got infrastructure as a service, where you end up deploying the entire database yourself and managing it yourself. Now let's look at some of that. So software as a service, when you talk about Azure, you've got Fabric infrastructure for that. Then you can bring in all the databases, data sets from different parts of your organization and analyze them in Fabric and use them from there. You've got platform as a service, where you need to think about whether your data is relational or non-relational. Now, relational databases, you've got PostgreSQL, non-relational, Cosmos DB, especially in Azure. And then if you have cache, then Redis cache and also Databricks, right? So all of those options for platform as a service define and decide based on the type of data you have. You might be using all of these options depending on where your data is and what you're trying to do. But the last one is infrastructure as a service. I personally think the hardest to manage, if you've got a lot of resources, go ahead, do this. But I would recommend trying to see if platform as a service or software as a service are the options that that fit better, right? Now, SQL Server or any other Postgres or your own non-relational database, if you want to bring that, host it yourself, then your option is infrastructure as a service. All right, from there, once you have your databases sorted and where you're setting them up, you need to start hooking that up into your AI models, right? What are you going to do with this data? And you're most likely solving a problem with this application that you're building. And that is where this problem statement becomes extremely important. What are you trying to do? Maybe you're analyzing images. Maybe you are analyzing some text. Maybe you're doing all of that together. Maybe you're working on some video analysis. So define the problem statement. And based on that, you would be making a choice. The first thing you do is making a choice on the models. That is where your reasoning would happen. We've got thousands of options in Azure AI Foundry. Now, Azure AI Foundry is the umbrella platform that you're going to use for all your AI-related needs. First is the model choice that we are talking about. You've got open source models. You've got foundational models, the frontier models that Microsoft has built as well, and then the task-based and industry-specific models. You're going to pick one or a few based on your task and your use case. And then you need to think about the creation and orchestration of your agent. So agent orchestration is a part of Foundry. So you're going to be able to build agents either through API or through a graphical user interface. And and connect the agents together for a specific task that you're trying to do. And the agent is going to have that hook into the model that you selected. And from there, you're going to also have to think about safety of these models. You've got lots of features on AI safety within Azure AI Foundry. Then you'd have to evaluate, customize, govern, and operate. I kind of put all of those in the same bucket, which is how do you productionize your model or your application? All those four things fall into that bucket. Anything that you're going to put in production would require those four things, right? So based on that, Azure AI Foundry is kind of that one-stop shop for making your model choices and then building your agent frameworks and agent orchestration things and also operating it. Now, once you have answered those questions, where do you actually run the application itself, right? Now, this is that infrastructure question that we need to answer. This really highly depends on what your team is and what type of team do you have, right? Lean teams, smaller teams, and how agile do you want to be with your application? So based on that, now I would highly recommend, this is my recommended approach, you could totally put your AI agent in a virtual machine, no problem with that, but I don't recommend it because it's going to be one, a lot of work, you need a team to manage and maintain all of that. I would go with some sort of a microservice architecture, different agents or multiple agents in their microservices architecture. Definitely got to use containers, right? I've got some options here. And then I would personally go with the serverless option just to keep things super simple and get to market value much faster. In this case, I'm saying container apps, Azure Functions works perfectly. We've got support for MCP in Azure Functions now. So that's my recommendation, but again, not to say that you can't do it in a virtual machine or in any other, in a higher IaaS or PaaS environment. Second last thing I'll talk about is the integrations, right? You've got the application ready. You made your choices on AI agents, the models you're using, you've put it in an infrastructure. You got to connect it with some sort of other applications because it's not going to just be standalone, right? That is where APIs come in. You're going to integrate some sort of API with this application, and those are going to be standardized through model context protocol, and you will expose those as MCP servers that can then be used in all of the connections of this agent into the external world, if you will. And the last thing is the developer productivity. I think this is extremely important. I think we forget about this when we're just thinking about applications, but your developers are going to also have to change a little bit of how they work when you're talking about building AI applications. So I think it's highly important to talk about developer productivity and the tools they'd be using to do this job of creating the AI, intelligent AI applications. So let's talk a little bit about software development lifecycle. It kind of starts from ideation to planning to then model evaluation. And I've added this step as extra from like traditional software development lifecycle because models and when you're talking about AI applications, model evaluation and AI-assisted coding are sort of those new elements that are being introduced into the software development lifecycle. And then the rest of it is the same, right? Test, review, deploy it, modernize it, continue the same process and iterate on it. Now, with that context or framework in mind, let's look at optimizing that developer productivity with AI. What are the tools that developers would use? So when we talk, and I've categorized them in sort of three categories. The first thing is code, right? So that's where we've got VS Code with all the extensions, VS Studio, GitHub Copilot extension. You can use it in agent mode, and you can deploy through MCP into the Azure environment. So you've got, and you can connect with Azure to understand how I build something. So that's that code part. That's where you've got all the assistance with all these tools. Then you come into build and maintaining, which is where Copilot, again, coding agent and agent mode come into picture. Wherever you're building, assuming here VS Code or VS Studio, right? And then GitHub repos, issues and actions kind of come in that build and maintaining part, and then you end up deploying it. Deployment could be anywhere you're deploying. I'm assuming, let's say it's one of the clouds, right? In Azure, I've got MCP connectors to deploy directly from VS Code into Azure and then operating would be that last step where you've got SRE capabilities and then Azure AI Foundry with the integration of what kind of model am I hooking up my code with, right? So with that, I'm going to leave you with, these are really the ingredients you got to think about when you're thinking about an AI application to be built on Azure infrastructure, databases, your AI reasoning models that you're going to choose, how are you going to connect them with the external world and the AI agents, along with security, monitoring, and your developer tools to make all of this come to life. With that, hopefully this was helpful to demystify the Azure platform for building AI apps. I'm going to see you in the next episode of Sip and Sync. Until then, don't forget to let us know how you're liking this show. Let me know in the comments what you'd like to see next. Thank you.